But why bother? What's the point? Because, you know, who uses these computers anyway? I mean, we've all got smartphones and tablets and gaming consoles and other single-purpose devices that are not really intended to be general-purpose computers. You know, this is us. This is everybody, you know, we're on our phones all day. So what's the point? Why still use these? Well, it turns out a lot of people still do, and they're who we're targeting. We're talking about students and teachers. Students and teachers still use real computers. A lot of us fall in this category. Office workers and business professionals, same thing. This kind of work can typically not really be done on a tablet or a smartphone very easily. We've also got software developers that includes a whole lot of us over here. So we're all very familiar with that difficult or possible it is to build software on a tablet. I don't know if any of you have ever tried it. We have creative professionals too. This kind of workflow often requires them. We have to cut off content there. But we're professionals is over there. And we've got IT professionals and system administrators too. They also use real computers. You have to pretty much. And we've also got gamers, people who play lots of video games. Even though mobile has taken over the gaming scene, there's still lots of video games out there. So what ties these people together? What do they want from their computers? It turns out there are a lot of commonalities here. For the most part, what they want is they want high stability and reliability for their computers. They don't want to have to be troubleshooting and fixing problems. They want good defaults. They don't want to have to do a really intensive amount of customization. Some of them may want to, but few of them want to have to do this. They also want good file access and management features because they're often working with different locations. They may be working with Samba shares or NFS shares or other kinds of remote locations. Everything isn't always just in one place. They typically need Microsoft Office compatibility too. As much as we would all prefer that this wasn't the case, we live in a world where lots of people out there, almost everybody really, uses Microsoft Office. So it's important for us to be able to, you know, to operate with them. These people often follow the don't make me think model, which is everything should just work, really. They don't want to have to figure out everything every time they want to do something. And specifically, the students and teachers want good educational software. The office workers want really high quality document processing software. This is like image viewing and manipulation, PDF viewing and manipulation, especially, that's really important. And they need Microsoft Exchange compatibility, because most major workplaces use Microsoft Exchange. Creative professionals want artistic and design software. Thankfully, we have a whole lot of that in KDE here. They can print it in particular, which is just fantastic. But that's the kind of thing they need. Software and IT professionals want a very productive Unix-like environment. They typically prefer to develop in this as opposed to Windows. And gamers want high-quality games. We're going to forget about the games for the rest of the talk because, unfortunately, we don't have much to offer them at KDE. But basically, these people just want to get stuff done. That's what they want to do. They don't want this computer to be a hobby. They want their computer to be a productive tool. And they want the operating system to help them do this and not get in the way of it. So I'm going to introduce the Usability and Productivity Initiative now. This is something that the KDE community settled on as one of our major goals late last year. And what this encompasses is the dual goals of usability and productivity. What do I mean by usability? Usability means the defaults. The software should support what most people want to do most of the time, not what a tiny group of people want to do all the time. And it should be tweakable for them, but we need to make sure that the defaults are good for the common case. It also means consistency. This means a lot of different things. It means that our apps look and feel the same way, they behave the same way. It means that theming is consistent, that icons are consistent, things like that. Because when things that behave the same look different, things that look different behave the same, it confuses people. It makes them slow down, which makes it difficult for them to use the machine. This also means discoverability. That means that you should be able to figure out how the software works without having to read the manual, without having to go online and ask for help. the software should be largely self-documented. And in addition, you need natural language rather than jargon. We need to make sure that all these phrasing things in English that people can understand. And we need to make it really easy to find, install, upgrade, and remove software. This is really important because most people use lots and lots of different apps. They don't just use what the operating system provides. And we need to make it easy for people to do that stuff. And all of this pretty much falls under simple by default, which is half of Buzz's slogan. The other half is productivity. And by productivity, what I mean is that our software needs to have really useful, powerful features. The kind of things to save people time. So instead of having to spend an hour going through a really tedious workflow, the software should help them do it in 10 seconds. That's the kind of thing I'm thinking about. It needs shortcuts. Our apps should have lots and lots of shortcuts for experts and people who use the same app over and over again so that they can streamline their workflows and be very, very, very fast at it. It means, in general, that whatever task they have, they should be able to accomplish things really quickly and easily. This is a powerful and needed side of our stuff. And all of this is documented at my blog, which many of you read. It's pointystick@wordpress.com. I post something every Sunday about what we've accomplished on this, and I hope you enjoy that, those of you who are aware of it. So let's get into the actual steps that we need to accomplish this. Step number one is to improve the new user contribution process. And I think that this is kind of the foundation of everything, because we got a problem, and that problem is that we don't have resources. Our software library is really expansive, it's huge, but oftentimes we don't have enough people to support and maintain and improve all of our stuff. So it's really important that we help new people to integrate into KDE as easily as possible so that they can get involved. And some of the things that we can do to make this possible are we can make it easier to set up a development environment. That's really important because right now it's kind of hard to do that. We can improve our documentation for new users. We can increase our promo and outreach efforts. And finally, this may sound a little silly, but we can work consulting our users. It can be really easy sometimes to get into a negative mindset of users, especially when you get a bug report that's insulting you. I'm sure all of you have created bug reports where people say, it's broken, fix it, this stuff is terrible, I hate it. And it's really tempting to, you know, respond in kind, but we need to make sure that we're always diffusing that kind of thing, because we can turn people who dislike our stuff into really loyal fans if we show them the positive side of what we can do. And I think if we succeed at this, what we're ultimately going to get is more manpower. We're going to get people's pet bugs fixed. We're going to get better quality of everything overall. And this is almost most importantly, unfortunately, there's a piece to cut off. I apologize for that. But the final point is a sense of forward momentum. And this is really important because it builds on this stuff. When people sense forward momentum in a project, they want to join it. When people sense a project is dead, they want to stay away from it, even if they like it. So it's really important that you be seen as a project that's going somewhere. Number two on our list of things that we have to do, we have to fix long-standing issues. These are things that damage our reputation and make it hard for users. I'm talking about things like Discover, the blue file indexer, Samba sharing, and network location management, NVIDIA, lit input, multi-screen. These are things that sometimes we've had challenges with in the past. And these things are broadly improving, but I think some of these are really going to be key features towards increasing the attractiveness of our platform. And if we manage to do this, then people are going to have the features that they need, and our software is going to be more competitive. And finally, another result of this is that we're going to replace bad press with good press. A lot of this is tied into promo, because the bad press is something that's really hurt us, and if we can manage to replace all of that and be seen in a really positive light and everybody, then more people are going to want to join, which goes back to step one. So in step number three, we're going to polish the user interface. Steps number two and three are pretty much part of the usability and productivity initiative. This is sort of getting back of it. The problem here is just a lack of polish. Our software is really great, but sometimes it's not as polished as it could be. And so what I'm proposing, and this is part of the initiative, is that we temporarily focus our resources on, you know, fixing little bugs, making system settings broadly more usable, improving the default settings, increasing the consistency, streamlining offer or those things like that. Things that I don't think are very popular right now. It's just a matter of kind of pointing it out and dealing with it. And if we can do this, then I think we're going to start to really attract a whole lot of converts from other platforms who have historically shied away from our stuff because of the perception that it's sort of buggy and has poor usability. And I don't think this is true anymore. But I think the more we can improve on this, the easier it's going to be for those people to want to get on our platform than we were there before. Finally, once we've got this, our software is looking in a really fantastic state after steps 1 through 3. And then it's time to work with distro partners more intensively than we're currently doing it. Because not a distro ship our software. You know, it's hard for users to get our software quite a bit. And I think what we need to do is we need to increase our promotion efforts, and we need to reach out to distros to make sure that they're aware of what we've got. And I'm specifically thinking of distros that ship the maintainable forks of known GDK software. There are a lot of distros out there that do this, and over time, they inevitably have trouble maintaining their software as they converge from known to GDK infrastructure. And I think those distros can be really good candidates for conversion. And if we can do this, then I think KDE Plasma will be used by default on all distros, and we're going to, if not get them to use Plasma, we can get them to ship really good KDE apps. Once we've got that, then we can work with hardware partners, because ultimately people don't really buy software, they buy hardware. They buy a new computer, and whatever operating system is on that computer, other than people like us, we're all weirdos here, those people stay with the same operating system that ship on their computers. That's why we have to work with our hardware partners. So this process involves more promoting outreach, pitching what we've got to them, and especially vendors of really low-cost hardware. These people often struggle with the cost of developing either their own OS or the license for Windows. So I think low-cost hardware can be a really good opportunity for us to improve our market share there. And if we can do this, then it's going to be more possible for your average person to walk into a store and come out with a computer that has KDE Plasma on it. They might not even know what it is, but that's what they're going to walk out with. And they're not going to think, hey, this isn't Windows, I don't like it. They're going to really enjoy it, because regardless of what it is, they find that it's fantastic because of steps 1, 2, and 3. And once we've got all of that, I think it's time to finally put a lot of effort into the personal information suite. You know, key mail, keyboard organizer, all that stuff. This is really important because up until now, I've been thinking of regular ordinary users, but in the business world, people need PIM software. They live and die by it. And as long as Microsoft Exchange and Office have a stranglehold on this market, it's really hard for us to break in. So I think after we've got all of this, we'll have some engineering resources, and we'll be able to really aggressively focus our efforts on improving the PIM suite. We can make the backend more reliable, we can polish the user interface on the front end, we can make it more compatible with Active Directory and Microsoft stuff, and then we can also encourage distros to ship it by default. Some don't right now because of negative perceptions and user feedback. And I think if we can improve the state of the software itself, more distros are going to want to ship it. And then once that happens, it's going to be actually an alternative to Office. People are going to say, hey, why am I paying gobstoppers of money for Microsoft Office and, you know, and that the Active Directory Exchange stuff when I can have this free software that's just as good? Once that's done, then I think what we need to do is put our resources into LibreOffice for a little bit. LibreOffice is really good. I did this presentation with LibreOffice, but it's unfortunately just not really a perfect replacement for Office just yet. It lags in certain key areas. It's great, but not good enough. And I think that's one of the things that we can do. We have a lot of engineering talent here, and once we've taken off some of the pressure on our own software, I think we can donate some of that effort to the LibreOffice community and help to improve their stuff. With the end result that it works better on our platform, that it'll look better, it'll feel better, it'll have better usability, and it will be more competitive with alternatives out there. And I think that's really going to be a very important final step. So what does all this look like? This looks like we have software that is stable and reliable, and it's seen as stable and reliable, almost more importantly, it is chock full of new friendly features. It has a personal information management component that performs well in a business environment, not just for home users, but in a business environment. And it's pre-installed in hardware, so you can get it without having to install it yourself. And I think that once we've got all of this stuff, the whole world will fall. Everybody's going to say, I want KDE software, it's the best, give it to me right now. You know, how can this be free? It's amazing. So are we there yet? Well, not yet, but we're getting there. So for our new contributor friendliness goal, I'm just going to give a shout out to Neil Fintos right now for proposing this and spearheading this. This is a really important effort. And in many ways, this is the foundation of everything. Because if we don't have enough new contributors, we can't do anything else. Thankfully, we've made good progress on this. We've improved our documentation, we've improved the process of setting up the development environment. There's much more to do, but I think we've made good progress. The usability and productivity goal, that's the one that I'm focusing on. We've likewise made good progress. There is weekly improvement. This is highly visible. Users see it. Users like it. Users appreciate it. And I think we're going in the right direction there. In terms of distro and vendor partnerships, this is an ongoing goal. I think this is something that we're going to ramp up in the future. And for improvements to the PIMS, this is likewise ongoing. So once we get done with the first two, I think we'll have maybe some more leeway and resources to focus on the next two. And finally, LibreOffice improvements, that really is to be determined. I don't think we have any active efforts going on there. But I do encourage all of you, help out with LibreOffice. It's really appreciated. And now I'm open it up for some questions.
Low-cost hardware, but I think it's kind of a two-edged
completely agree with you. I think we shouldn't actively target any specific market beyond all the other ones. But I think this one may have the possibility, there may be more growth potential for us there, because they kind of struggle with other offerings, especially in the Linux space, because our software runs really, really well on low-cost hardware right now. And I think if we do put more effort into that, that will have dividends for even people who have high-power hardware, because whenever you make anything lighter and easier to run, it's better for everybody, not just those who have hardware that requires that. So I agree with you, we shouldn't focus on actually the exclusion of all else, but I think that is an important part of the market. Not all, definitely, but a part of it.
I also want to add some to the discussion. Mm-hmm. I have three topics. Basically, the first topic is even Microsoft knows that there is no average user, and it's completely impossible to us to have extremely good defaults or so-called default user, because this default user does not exist. Microsoft itself, they have the same problem, and they came up with the concept of so-called personas, and they have six different personas, or really in hard call, they have some code names, and they can default these differences as personas, because that's not going to work. This average field is just not existing. You put too much, your expectations will be too high. The second point I want to mention is, when we started KDE, we were actually stretching our own edges, and we really wanted to use ourselves. We wanted to prevent it from having before C or Windows 95, whatever. And the goal we set that we could use software for a totally different audience, which has very different needs from ourselves, this is a very, very difficult thing, because we're not going to meet our own doctors anymore. And this can be done in a company setup, but it's very difficult for us. So think about that, if that maybe this goal cannot be reached or it has to be reached differently. And last but not least, I've been involved in the topic of interoperability with Microsoft, especially Microsoft Exchange and Microsoft Outlook from the very beginning. I did the group where I made contact and then Colab server and everything. And I even founded a company just with the single purpose of creating interoperability with the Microsoft servers. And I can tell you, it didn't cost me, that's not funny, it didn't cost me nearly a million euro. And finally, I had to talk because I figured out that technically it is not possible. You will never, ever, so many people tried it, including myself. I invested, I can tell you a lot of the past, they're really good. I know now the technical reasons why this is not going to work. You will not get it to a point where people can rely on it. If it's not working reliably, it's the same like when your alarm clock is not ringing in the morning. You will do that sometimes, and then after some days, you will be really troubled. Because the same kind of thing, if it's not reliable, you get into a big problem.
So thank you very much for your experience there. That's something that I would really like to learn from. It is true that compatibility with Microsoft software is impossible by design. I believe that, and if that's the case, then maybe we should give up on this and instead say, if we can't interoperate with them, we got to beat them. Our stuff has to be so much better that nobody wants to use their junk. They want to use our stuff instead. So maybe that's the answer. On your second point, which is that we're all scratching our own edges here, and we don't want to dumb down the software, I completely agree. I'm scratching my edge too. I don't want to use dumbed down software. And I think that's why a lot of us are using KDE software instead of some other software that's in the Linux space. I think it's really important that we acknowledge that this isn't an either or. It isn't a matter of have software that's really simplistic so that regular people can use it, or have software that's really powerful so that experts can use it. I believe that it's possible to have both. I think that this is one of the things that the VDG, KDE Visual Design Group was founded to solve this problem, so that we can have software that is simple by default and powerful when needed. And all of us fall into the powerful when needed camp. This isn't powerful hidden behind a bunch of settings that nobody can define. This isn't slightly powerful but crippled. It's fully powerful. Powerful when needed, but simple by default. And I think if we can manage to get this balance right, we will simultaneously attract more people who don't need that power while not hiding any of it from us. I'm not in any way, shape, or form proposing to reduce the power of our software. It needs to be there, it needs to be obvious, it needs to be accessible, but maybe it doesn't need to be the very first thing people see, you know? Not everybody's a software developer.
Norm has also been a great work on compatibility to Microsoft Office, they release a new version with new icons. Nobody needs new icons and have a shiny creation. We want to have compatibility. Mm-hmm. In the end, LibreOffice can't win this game because you can't have 100% compatibility to Microsoft Office. And I'm not sure if you really need 100% compatibility. Also the same, it can't be 100% compatibility to Exchange. But we have Excel, we have LibreOffice Online, we have solutions, free solutions, open source solutions. They are as good, but open, and didn't have any proper privacy issues. So I'm not sure you want to fight against Microsoft Office, but Microsoft operation systems and services, because I'm not sure if you can win this game.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying. By the way, thank you so much for your work on icons for Breeze and also for LibreOffice. It's really fantastic work. I think Andreas deserves some applause for that. And the subject of LibreOffice and Microsoft, I hear what you're saying. It echoes what we said earlier. I think my response is going to be the same, which is that if we can't interoperate with them, it's all the more important that we leave them, that we say, hey, you know, don't use that because this stuff is better and it's free and you don't have to pay for it and your data will never be tracked in there. So, you know, we've just got to keep up the polish work to make sure that LibreOffice is as attractive an alternative.